So we're going to talk about normal before we can talk about abnormal. Again, this is the review. The sit back, relax. Whew, take a few notes to help you understand, but this is the review. I need you to understand normal because then it makes abnormal so much better. So you may see these words as you're reading things and as you're talking about cardiac. I will use these words extensively, so I need you to know what they mean. Preload, afterload, and contractility. If you're going to do anything in cardiac forever, they will become your life. Preload, it has to do with the amount of circulating volume, the amount of fluid the heart has to deal with. Think about it as the fluid returning to the heart. Okay. Preload, returning to the heart, what does the heart have to deal with? Afterload is the pressure the heart has to pump against. So preload is fluid, afterload is pressure. Contractility is actually the strength of the heart muscle. So those are basic concepts. You're like, yeah, I got it. But I'm going to keep reusing these all the time. So let's talk about how do you assess preload? How do you assess the amount of volume that you have in your body? Thoughts? Not blood pressure, unfortunately. Unfortunately, because we can have a blood pressure even when we don't have a lot of volume. So ejection fraction is down here. There we go, edema. Edema is a great measure of how much fluid we have to deal with. So, well, let's see. I'm going to put them up. Edema is on there. So basically the only two things we have to tell how much volume we have running around is we have jugular venous distension, which is basically where you're sitting upright and you can see jugular veins sticking out, not pulsing, the veins sticking out. That means there's a lot of fluid returning to the heart that's just not getting in through the heart. Okay. We'll talk about it another slide. Peripheral edema is our biggest one. If you have peripheral edema, you got a lot of fluid in your body. It's been shoved out of the bloodstream, you have so much. So that's really our biggest clue without any diagnostics to figure out how much fluid we have circulating around. We just figure if you got edema, you got too much. Your body has pushed it out of the bloodstream and into the tissues. We have too much. If you do have advanced monitoring, which we'll talk about in hemodynamics, which is where we start monitoring stuff out on the pole, the wall, we have essential venous pressure. Where do we read essential venous pressure?
A central line.
Arterial lines don't tell us our central venous pressure. It has to be in a central line that is dumping back into the heart. It's the only way we can read essential venous pressure. So I will talk about these when we do hemodynamics. But really, those are our big tools to measure how much volume we have in our body. So that's what we're looking at there, and we'll talk about a normal central venous pressure and everything about that, but that is where we have a tip of our catheter returning to the heart, and it's measuring the pressure in there. If your central venous pressure is high, do you have a lot or a little bit of fluid in there? The pressure is high in the central venous system. You have a lot of fluid. It's engorged. There's so much fluid in there. So a high central venous pressure means you have a lot of fluid. A low central venous pressure means you don't have very much fluid. Let's talk about afterload. This is arterial resistance to the heart pumping out. That's your blood pressure. And which part of your blood pressure? Diastolic. Diastolic blood pressure measures your afterload. Okay? That is the pressure that your heart has to push against. Systolic is when the heart has pumped into the blood vessels. Diastolic is when the blood vessels are at their most empty and the heart's now going to fill them. So that is your resting, that's your what your heart's pushing against, meaning that that is the least empty, or that's the most empty blood pressure, that's the most empty vessel, and your heart's pushing into it. And then that gives you your systolic. So when you're reading pressures, we're actually reading how much pressure is against the vessel wall. So when your diastolic is 60, is there a lot of pressure against your vessel walls? No, it's empty. And then your heart goes and fills that artery, and now there's pressure against it. And so that's what we're reading when we read the systolic and diastolic. But our afterload is our diastolic blood pressure, which is why when they say hypertension, you worry about a high diastolic, more than a high systolic. We worry about a high diastolic because if your blood pressure, your diastolic is 90, your heart has to push against that pressure to fill. It means your vessels are already pretty constricted, and your heart has to push against a very constricted vessel. If your diastolic is 40, you got a sewer pipe to fill. It's huge, big old blood vessel, and the heart doesn't have a lot of pressure to push against, but it's still gonna have to work hard to fill it to get you to a decent systolic pressure. So basically, when we are looking at your diastolic, that is a beautiful measure without looking at anything else of how constricted or how dilated you are. So when you look at a patient that has a lot of vasodilation going on, like a septic patient, if you have a septic patient in the ICU, those patients are vasodilated because of a illness. Sepsis creates vasodilation. Sometimes they have systolic blood pressures in the 30s. You'll see like 90 over 30. Very different than 90 over 60. 90 over 30 means you got a big sewer pipe that the heart's trying to fill up. So basically afterload, basically whenever you look at your diastolic, that is a beautiful measure. It's really the only thing we need to measure what your heart is resisting. And so we want it. What's our normal diastolic? 60 to 80. We like 60 to 80. The diastolic of 70 is great. Diastolic of 60 is fine. Diastolic of 80 is fine. We start worrying when it gets higher than 90. And we start worrying when it gets lower than 60. We're starting to have vasodilation and vasoconstriction that's going to affect the heart. So that's your best one. Then there's the advanced one, and you can only get this one off of a pulmonary artery catheter, so we don't get that one very often. But this is an actual measure of your systemic vascular resistance, and it does math and calculations and magic to tell you exactly how constricted and dilated your artery system is. But we don't need it. We have a diastolic blood pressure. It's wonderful. It's perfect. And so if you remember diastolic blood pressure, measure of afterload, that's pretty much all you need. And then contractility, how strong the heart is. How strong the heart is pumping. What do you think we use to measure that? Yeah. That one we can't get without some kind of invasive number, because how do we go in and measure the heart? We have to do something kind of invasive. What do you think we could do that's not invasive at all that will tell you?
Capillary refill or skin color?
Yes, cap refill, skin color, pulses. Pulses, skin warmth, and cap refill. Those are our best measurements of how strong our heart is beating. Because if we don't have warm skin, good cap refill, that heart is not perfusing out for whatever reason. We have great pulses. So if we have palpable pulses, we probably have a pretty decent heart. If you've been through SIM with me already, I told you that a pulse pressure here in the carotids means that you have a blood pressure of at least 40 to 50. So that means that the heart has pushed out enough to fill the carotid arteries. If you have a blood pressure in your femorals, or you have pulses in your femorals, that means your heart has pushed out enough to get you a pressure of 70 to 80 systolic. I'm talking systolic. But basically, this means that the heart has enough strength to fill up all the way down to the femoral arteries, or does it have enough strength to only fill the carotid arteries? And then if you have a brachial pulse or a radial pulse, either peripheral pulses or pedal pulses, you've got a pressure greater than 80. You got a pressure greater than 90 because the heart has now been able to strength, it has enough strength to perfuse all the way to the extremities. And that's a great blood pressure, but it's also contractility. If your heart is weak and not pumping well, it's gonna barely reach the extremities. So when you start losing your pulses and your radii, they're starting to get weaker, we have a weaker heart. It's just not able to pump strong enough to fill all the way to the tips of your toes and the tips of your fingers. So we will assess the contractility mostly with pulses and warmth and cap refill. Now we can go ahead and put extra things in and do extra tests. you can get a cardiac output and a ejection fraction. You have to get a cardiac echo or go to the cath lab and get things or put in central lines that measure cardiac output. Much more invasive when we have the ability to do pulses, warmth, and tap refill. The reason we do the advanced ones is because we probably lost our strong pulses, lost our skim warmth, tap refill, and we know our heart's in trouble, and we need to figure out how deeply in trouble it is. Then they'll put in the advanced stuff. But if someone's got pulses to their feet, we don't need to measure their cardiac output. It's great. It works really well. The other thing we can use to measure is if our kidneys work, is urine output. They call that a cardiac output detector as well. If you can perfuse the kidneys, then to have no urine output, then it works. So we like to look at the body to figure out whether our heart works, because basically it's a pump. And if your pump is broken, things don't perfuse. So we want to make sure that things are perfusing. Any questions on that?
So yes. My question just on afterload, is that just like, so just to like make sure like I'm understanding it, it's just like how hard the heart has to work to pump
out. It's resistance. So preload is fluid, afterload is resistance, and contractility is actually the strength of the heart, okay? Just concepts that I will use again and again, so I want to make sure we have clear. Cardiac assessment, I'm not going to spend too long on because you've done all this. We will play with Love Dove, but what I'm going to tell you is Love, end of diastole. Dub is end of systole. So when you hear lub, we will talk about this next week in valve. Lub is valves closing, signifying that we're about to start another cycle. So lub dub tells you systole, diastole. And then your JVD. So these are just basically how to measure all these things. Here's a picture of what JVD looks like. This is distended veins. We're not talking about muscle builders that have such a thick neck that their veins can't collapse into their skin. We're talking about normal people sitting upright. Now, if you're laying down, it doesn't count. You only have JVD if you have it sitting upright, 45 degrees or higher. Because this means that even sitting upright, what do you think would happen if you had a lot of jugular, you had a lot of fluid in your veins and you sit upright? It should pull down. It means it's so backed up, there's nowhere for it to go. So if you have jugular venous distension while sitting up, you do have a problem, either too much preload or a really bad heart. We have to kind of dig down into it. Huh? It can be, because guess where the fluid's not going? Through the heart. So whenever we see JVD, we have an issue that the heart can't handle the return. And we have backup. And so we need to kind of look more into it. That's not a normal finding. We shouldn't see it. You probably remember all this from block one, but I am going to put it up that this does have actual criteria to it. Like a lot of people are just looking at someone and being like, plus three. There is criteria to it. I mean, you know, you've seen it. You're like, yeah, plus three. But the thing is there is, like, if you pit, and it goes away right away, it's plus one. If you pit and it goes away 10 to 15 seconds, so it's like a, how long does it take to re-unpit, basically, is your degree of edema. So I just wanted to kind of refresh that for you.
See, yeah. I was taught differently. I was taught three,
how
three
deep it goes?
Seconds. No, if it takes more than 3 seconds, then it's greater than three. That was 11 years ago, though.
Well, and that might be, I don't know, maybe they're trying to make it easier, but these are...
Yeah, because I was thinking, okay, I've been doing that wrong
me too.
For a really long time.
Yeah. So that's the thing, is that we don't want to classify someone with something they don't have. So anyway, go through there. But the other thing, too, is it doesn't matter how long it lasts. If it's more than an inch deep, you can call it 4-plus edema. Okay. So there's kind of two criteria on it. So if you're, like, sticking your finger in there and you're getting, I mean, more than an inch deep, that's a thumb, right? An inch is a thumb. Think about how Michelin man you have to be to get 4-plus pitting edema. More than an inch? Dang, your finger's, like, going in there, not coming out. And then, of course, it's going to take a while to come back up. You pushed it in an inch. Lord have mercy, not many people should be 4-plus pitting edema. That's pretty bad. Yeah.
So is there a best place to do it or just where they look the most?
The best place to do it would be in your extremities, so hands or feet.
So whichever one looks worse, you would do it.
Probably, yeah. I mean, generally your feet are your most distal. This is basically measuring, can your blood return to your heart? And if you have edema, we usually measure it in the feet. You can measure, I mean, I've had people with pitting edema in their arms, but most of the time we measure it in the feet. Because that's usually where most fluid accumulates is in the feet, because it's our most distal portion. Anyway, you know skin, you know cap refill. Pulses, again, you should know the pulses. I do want to point out that this is subjective. It doesn't have as much of a, you know, if we can feel it without hunting too hard, we give it normal or three. If we have to hunt around a little bit for it and it's not as easily distinguished, we'll give it a one, or you have to kind of really feel for it. But what I'm going to tell you is that never, ever, 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 ever chart absent unless the pulse is gone. That is a documentable finding, meaning you're probably going to lose the extremity if we don't do something. Pulse is absent, you have to be sure. You cannot write a zero unless you ruled it out with a Doppler, okay? You have to use a Doppler before you chart zero. Yes?
Professor, so how do you do it? Like, because my biggest obstacle is getting the fetal pulses on, let's say, on a patient that's, let's say, morbidly obese or somebody with a really bad circulation. Doppler. See, this is something that not every place has.
Doppler. Well, I mean,
just say they don't have
but you don't say absent.
Just say they don't have it.
Yeah, you
no,
can't
no,
say
can
absent.
Say obviously, it's not
whatever
it's
you
not
choose,
saying.
If they have, you know, there have been times where I can't feel it, I don't know, but it's warm and it's, you know, got good cap refill, I kind of just put plus one or a Doppler rule. But you do need to, before you put zero, Doppler it. Okay? You do not need an order for a Doppler. It is not an invasive test. Just like you don't need an order for a bladder scan, you can just scan. You can Doppler any pulse that you need to, if you have one. Most places, though, do have a Doppler somewhere, because if you're doing cardiac assessment, you may not feel them, especially if someone has 2 or 3 plus pitting edema. They have pulses. We just can't feel them, so we have to Doppler them. So a Doppler is pretty necessary to be sure that you have a pulse. So please just don't write absent, because if you've written absent on a pulse, that needs to be notified to somebody. That's a you know, if you're a mandated reporter, that's a mandating report as an absent pulse. Yes?
So say you can't find it, you get the Doppler, you're checking it. What is the Doppler just going to tell you what the rate is if it's there?
No, the Doppler, you can hear it. When you, I'll have to find a Doppler. It is basically where you will put the Doppler over the pulse, and you can hear it whoosh, whoosh.
What would you then whoosh. Rate it if you can't think
Doppler.
Of it?
Doppler. Oh, you rate it Dopplerable. Okay. Yeah. And that is perfectly fine, because that's saying, we don't know, we couldn't feel it, but it was there. So people will write DP for Dopplerable, or write Doppler or present on Doppler, but you will chart it as Dopplerable pulse. So that is something that I'll see if I can find a Doppler. So I don't think we have one here. But yeah, it is like if you've ever gone, if you've ever been pregnant and they measure baby's fetal heart tones, that's a Doppler. But you hear, you can hear, like, I mean, we can grade it based on how strong and loud it is. There's faint Doppler, there's strong Doppler, but they're still all, like, kind of subjective. But what I'm saying is, if you can't feel it, which you sometimes can't if they are heavily edematous, get a Doppler if you can, and most institutions do have it. Long-term care, maybe not, and then we'll probably go off of cap refill and warmth. These things we'll talk about. Pulsus alternans. Basically, this means that the pulse, when you're feeling it, goes strong, strong, weak, strong, 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 weak, strong, 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 weak. This means that every now and then, the heart's just not pumping out as strong. One of those beats is not a strong beat. This is usually felt with arrhythmias because you have a normal beating pulse. It's just not every single one is the same strength. Usually means that you have an arrhythmia somewhere along the line. Pulsus paradoxus means that your beat, so this is just kind of random. This means that when you're listening, you're feeling strong, strong, weak, 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 strong, 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 weak, weak, weak. But then you start paying attention to their breathing, and every single time they take a breath in, it gets weak. And then they exhale and it gets strong again. I have a pulsus paradoxus because I like to think that I'm a tiny person, even though I'm not really. But I have a tiny chest, and so when I take a breath in, what is it going to do to my heart? It's going to kind of compress it a little bit. The lungs take up space. And so when you are fully inspired, your heart can't pump as strong because it's getting squished a little bit. So you can see that it's not a strong one. But if you were listening to my pulse, it kind of, it's like strong, 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 weak, strong, 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 weak, weak. But it goes along with respirations. So pulsus paradoxus goes along with respirations. Pulsus alternans does not go along with respirations. Okay? So you can imagine that in a tiny person, this might be normal. I used to be a lot tinier. But in a large person, that's probably not a normal finding. It's also not a normal finding if it didn't exist when they were healthy. If they did not have pulsus, or like if, for me, it would be hard to distinguish. Like, oh, you have pulsus paradoxus. Well, you had it when you're healthy. You're going to have it when you're sick, too. But if you never had this and now you have this, it's a new finding. Like if you were taking assessment of people's pulses and it was strong and regular and no problems at all, and now it's strong, 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 weak, 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 strong, 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 weak, 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 it means the heart's being compressed with inspiration. If that was not a normal finding when they were healthy, then it's a new finding.
Can that be like an enlarged heart?
It could be. Yeah, the bigger the heart is and the more room it takes on the chest, anything that's going to cause the heart, and a lot of it is, this is the one that goes with tamponade, when the heart has a lot of fluid around it, and then when you inspire, it gets squished. So anything that, yeah, an enlarged heart will definitely get squished every time you take a breath in. So this is just anatomy, but that's what that means. If you see pulsus paradoxus, it means it goes with your respirations. Alternans is just, it's just diminishing and rising, but it doesn't really follow the respirations, usually an arrhythmia. Okay. Does that make sense? You're like, yay, I'm so glad we got into heart. This is just terminology so that when you see them, you understand that we have something that we need to look at. Because I'll use these when we do test questions. So I want to make sure we are on. I just want you to kind of know EKG versus telemetry. Hopefully you're already very familiar. Just continuous EKG reading. What kind of readings do we get continuously? So you can get your heart rate, but it's only 3 or 5 leads, okay? Here is your, well, and then 12 leads. So these are, a lot of people think continuous EKG is a 12 lead. It is not. You only have 3 or 5 leads continuously. Telemetry monitoring means that you have a continuous EKG, but it's just not hooked up to a monitor. It's still continuous EKG monitoring. Yes?
I think less EQ would have 6 leads.
What's that?
Less EQ would have used 6.
6 leads?
Yeah. I remember.
6 leads?
Yeah.
Which is the 6 leads?
Because like I know that Walton used to use 5, but less EQ would have used 6.
Oh.
Kind of like they don't even go like the middle one and then, you know, right here. They
okay.
go like something like all 5.
Good for them.
What is 6 leads?
Well, the 6 lead just gives you more information.
Right.
I'd have to look at that, see what the 6th lead is. I'm not exactly sure.
Yeah,
I wonder if it's the, I'll have to look.
Is she talking about the V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6, where they go?
Yeah,
well, that's,
I think that's what she's talking about.
Well, when we, so here's the, where did I put them? Where did I put them? Did I put the, did I pass it where I put, where you hook up? I thought I had a slide on here. I will look as we go through of how you hook up the leads. Normally, it's that you see lead 2, lead 3, lead AVF, So you see leads 1, lead 2, lead 3, and AVF with a regular 3 or 5 lead EKG. I'll have to see which leads the 6th lead looks at. It's on page 26.
Yeah.
So we'll get through. Why did I put it all the way down there? Probably because we were talking about how to get... So this is the 3 lead EKG, which is very basic. You basically get lead 1, 2, and 3. And that's what it's looking at. You get three things, but it's looking from the right side of your heart and seeing basically how electricity is flowing through the heart. So when you have 3 leads, you get lead 1, lead 2, lead 3. And then when you have 5 leads, you get lead 1, lead 2, lead 3. Oh, that's supposed to be a 3. Plus AVL, ADR, AVF. They're just different views of the heart. I'm not sure which view the 6th lead gives you, but it doesn't really matter. Just gives you more information. Because what it's doing is it's looking at the electricity from all these different angles and then giving you information about that. We'll go back. I'm not going to ask you any of those things. I don't even know it, so why would you need it? I'm trying to figure out what the 6th lead... And really, when we look at all those different leads, we're looking to see... Is there abnormalities in one or more of those leads? So it just gives you more stuff to look at. But the 12 lead, which is where you hook up the 5 leads plus the leads going around your chest, is not a continuous monitor. It's a one-time test, mostly because we just don't have monitors that read continuous 12 leads. So we don't hook up all the 12 lead monitors. Did you learn 12 lead in Block 2? And you probably don't need to learn 12 lead, but it's just basically those 5 leads plus there's 6 more across the sides of your chest. And I do have a 12 lead thing that I can put up there for you, but I'm not going to expect you to be able to read 12 leads. So I'm not going to introduce it right here. I just want you to know that 12 leads are not continuous at this point. Echoes are things where we just basically, it's an ultrasound of the heart. They can do them bedside. They can also put a scope down the back of your throat and do an echo from the back side of the heart, and that's called the transesophageal echo. They actually put a scope into your esophagus and do the echo from the back side of the heart. We can't really see the back side of the heart very well, and so that's the only way that we can really get in and look at the underside of the heart is with the transesophageal echo. We can put up hemodynamic monitoring. They can do treadmill testing. There's all these different tests to just give you more information about the heart.
What if they're hairy?
What's it?
If they're really hairy.
If they're really hairy, you have to shave them to get good conduction of electricity. Yeah, as much as everybody would just rip.
Yeah.
What I'm going to ask you to know about cardiac diagnostic exams.
Okay.
Right? He's like, okay, now I'm going to wake up.
I've been awake. I just want anyone else to share that.
I need you to know the troponin. I would like you to know what a normal troponin is. It's not very high. It's less than 0.4, all right? What is a troponin? It's a cardiac enzyme. And what do we use it for? For heart attack. It is for heart attack. A positive troponin means that there has been damage to the heart muscle. And the reason we like troponin is that we can see it within 12 hours. Troponin peaks rapidly and then disappears. So if you had an MI 3 days ago and are now just coming to the hospital, will the troponins be elevated?
No.
Troponins work within the first few hours. So your troponins, if you're having chest pain, they will do serial troponins. They do them every 6 hours. Because after 18 hours, we're not going to see it anymore. So they do it every 6 hours, and they look for arise. They're looking to see. So you come into the ER with chest pain, they're going to draw a troponin. Even if the troponin is 0, they will still probably check it. They'll admit you to rule out MI, and they will keep checking your troponins, because if your troponins now are up, you're in the middle of something right now. It's a very quick indicator of the fact of whether you're having an MI. If you're having an active MI, it will react fast and goes away. So it's not good at telling if you had an old MI, but it's telling if you're having a current MI. It is an enzyme that is released from the heart muscle when there's having damage. The other one, yes, and then there's the CKMB and the myoglobin. Those are also cardiac enzymes as well, but troponin is our most specific, and that's the one that they're going to be looking at. BNP. Have you seen BNP? This one's for heart failure. So if you know anything, troponin is for heart attack, BNP is for heart failure. It is able to recognize long-term heart, it's basically released when heart muscle is stretched. So when the heart muscle has been stretched out, it releases this BNP. And so BNP levels greater than 500 is indicative of heart failure. I've had people that come in and they have BNPs of 10,000.
Oh, wow. Oh my gosh.
The higher the BNP, the worse the heart failure. So someone coming into me with a BNP of 10,000, I don't need an echo. I bet you their pulses aren't great. I bet you their cap refill is not that good. I bet you they've got edema. They have heart failure. Their BNP is super high. And so all the other tests just confirm what you already know. So BNP, I want you to know, goes with heart failure.
Is there stages of CHF? Like, you know how kidney failure, there's like stage 3, stage 4,
There are stages, but unfortunately we don't see really signs and symptoms of it until their heart failure. So we talk about next week the criteria for what causes heart failure. But I want you to be concerned with a BNP greater than 500. That's not normal. We should be less than 100. So as soon as our BNP starts getting high, we're like, that's not bueno. And then if someone's coming in 10, 20,000, you don't even need any other tests.
I just didn't know if certain numbers related to certain.
No, we don't have staging like renal failure. Yeah. I mean, so if you want to memorize it.
As long as you're under 100 or 500, like any number between 100
and 100 to 500 is like, well, we're going to do more testing. It's going to buy you more testing. But you're not that bad off yet. But once you start getting over 500, you probably meet the criteria for heart failure. So just keep an eye on it. And that's what, you know, because we do have acute heart failure and chronic heart failure. So this BNP might not react right away to acute heart failure. But BNP means heart failure. So if I give you a test question of a patient with a BNP of 800 or 900, I'm going to want you to, that's one of your cues for heart failure. So, you know, remember, when you're collecting cues off of test questions, they're going to start pointing to you stuff. It's a confirmatory cue of heart failure. Ejection fraction is the other one that will probably be good. And any of your cardiac patients, if we're in clinical, I'll ask you, so what's the ejection fraction? What's the BNP? It gives us more information about the health of the heart. So if your patient has had any kind of cardiac or chest pain or any kind of long-term failure, they probably had an echo, which is where we get the ejection fraction. The only two tests that we can get an ejection fraction from are a heart catheterization or an echo. Okay, echo is a ultrasound of the heart, so easy to do, not invasive, and they probably will do that one first. The cardiac catheterization is where they go in through the femoral and actually look at the heart vessels. Either one can measure an ejection fraction, but any patient with chest pain or heart failure will probably have some one of those tests. And I will ask you, what's your ejection fraction? Because this number will be important to you, and you'll see it again. Less than 40% is heart failure. That is the diagnostic criteria for heart failure, is an ejection fraction less than 40%. So if your ejection fraction is 50, you're still okay. Not great. The normal one, 60 to 75. So us walking around with no cardiac history, this just means that how much fluid does your ventricle eject with each beat? Okay. When you wring out a sponge, you don't lose every piece of water out of the sponge, right? There's still something left in that sponge even after you wring it out fully. Even if you use all your strength to wring it out, it's still going to have water left in it, and so is the heart. When the heart beats, it's basically wringing out a sponge, fluids leaving to your body. And so we always are left with a little bit. What's
an analogy?
Thank you. But yeah, I mean, really, well, I've been doing patient teaching on cardiac, so I could teach you this one. Maybe the other one. But that's what we're doing, is the heart's wringing out blood. And so we are always left with probably about 25% of the blood left in the sponge or left in our heart. That's normal. We don't squeeze the sponge dry. But when you squeeze and it's only like a dribble, that's when we have a problem. So ejection fraction is an important number. And then cardiac output we can't get except with an echo, a heart catheterization, or we can put in a catheter that measures the cardiac output. This is just liters per minute. So really, those things we don't get. They're too invasive. So the biggest ones we'll do are the two blood tests and probably an ejection fraction, most likely off of an ultrasound because it's not invasive. If you do need to get invasive, what will this tell you? Your central venous pressure.
How long the heart is beating, the contractility.
It doesn't tell you contractility. It tells you preload. It tells you how is your heart handling the fluid returning to it. Okay? Most people, if they're fluid overloaded, what are they going to show?
Edema.
Most people, as soon as you become fluid overloaded, you push it out of the blood vessels into your tissues. Edema is your first sign. But maybe you're not edematous, but you have a high central venous pressure. You will be edematous soon. This is just an earlier marking. A high CVP will end up as edema. It always will. But we can maybe see something coming before it reaches the point of edema or tissues. And we just have to go in, and but it has to be a central line. But we can see the higher the CVP, the more fluid the heart is having to deal with. Okay. You could have just normal amounts of fluid in your volume. How much fluid do we have in our blood vessels? Do we know?
When you say fluid, you just mean blood.
I just mean blood. Yeah, when I say fluid in the blood vessels, I'm talking about all the components, plus water.
Isn't it like 2.5 liters?
It's about six liters.
Six.
About 6 liters is what we circulate around. So you can have a high CVP with still 6 liters floating around. So what I'm saying is that we have 6 liters floating around, but the heart's not pumping it out.
6 liters at a time.
Wait, we have 6 liters just rotating around, flowing around, going around and around and around. Let's say that our heart is weak, that our pump is broken. Think about it, pool pump, okay? You got a 6-liter pool pump, let's say, or a pond or something. Let's say your pump is backed up. Does it circulate around? 6 liters. Some of it gets stagnant, right? Well, that's what happens to our pump. The heart is a pump. If we have 6 liters to circulate around and the pump is broken, well, what's squirting out the side of the pool pump? Like if you've seen a pool fountain, right? You've seen a pool fountain that sprays water. Let's say our pump gets gunked up and it's not working. What does your spray look like? There's still 6 liters in the pond. But where's, is it spraying out the fountain?
Is that when you see it like backing into the lungs and stuff like that?
Exactly. Well, let's draw a diagram.
Okay.
Let's draw a diagram and we'll talk about that. So here's our kind of our diagram. This is the, thank you, that kind of segues me into my next section. This looks like this is all one thing. This all looks like this all works together, right? It's all pumping together. It is not. The heart is two pumps. It's not one pool pump, it's two. It just happens to be encased in one area, but it's two pumps. We have the right side of the heart, and we have the left side of the heart. The right side of the heart goes to the lungs, the left side of the heart goes out to the body. So let's see if I have my favorite picture. This is my favorite picture of the heart. The heart blown apart. Because what this is telling you is that we've got stuff in between. So when we're looking at signs of right heart failure and left heart failure, which we will look at next week, you could see that let's say the right heart is failing. What is happening in our body? This pump, broken. Well, it's backing up, right? What's out here?
Your lungs.
No, the lungs are over here. The lungs are in between.
Your body tissues.
Your body tissues, your spleen, your GI system. I have a picture further that puts the body on the outside, the venous return. So it starts backing up. The first sign we're going to see is jugular venous distension. High CVP, high central venous pressure. Because fluid's trying to get in, but it can't get through. So it's starting to back up. Yes.
Sorry. So central venous pressure, like I notice
we see more A lines, and we see central lines, but I saw the central lines more in the ICU than when we were at the ED. The ED, they went by the A line. Is there one?
A line is not measuring the same thing. An arterial line is just measuring your blood pressure.
Yeah, so the diastolic and the blood pressure there from the direct A line doesn't matter?
It does, but it can't tell us what side of heart failure we have. Because what's going to happen here, so this is blocked off. Let's call this the highway, okay? We got the I-10 here. And we got the 202 down here, okay? So we got the I-10, and they're doing construction on the I-10. It's all backed up. There's road closures here. Okay. What's going to happen to the traffic? Well, what's the traffic look like on the 202? It's clear as a bell because all the traffic's back here. So what we're going to see here is, depending on the side of the heart, we're going to see different symptoms in the blood pressure,
right, and heart failure.
But either one is going to cause a low blood pressure, okay, or not a good blood pressure. Because nothing's getting out. So let's say this is the 10, this is the 202, and this is, you know, out of Santan out here. You know? So if we're trying to get from the airport to Santan, this is the airport back here, and this is Santan down here, and you gotta get through two highways to get there. We're not talking about surface roads yet. But let's say the 10 is closed, and there's no other ways to get there. Let's just take those two highways, and that's all we got, okay? If we got the 10 to the 202, that's our only way. The 10 at baseline is blocked up, okay? All lanes closed. Well, we're going to have a huge backup at the airport, okay? Huge backup. What does get through is very weak stream. There's only a couple cars getting through, and that's what's getting all the way to Santan. So what's going to happen to your blood pressure if not a lot of fluid is going through? It's going to go down, okay?
Is this where they get tachycardic and low blood?
Exactly, because the heart is like, it doesn't know what's going on. It's just like, well, and then we'll talk about what's going to happen out here. So there's so many little systems involved in controlling this. But let's just talk about flow. So let's say the 10 is beautiful, fine, flowing beautifully, but our backup is now at, Gilbert, all right? We've got all four lanes closed at Gilbert now. You're flowing and you're riding like nobody's business until you get here, and now we have the backup here. What do you think our signs and symptoms are going to be if we have a left heart backup? Now we have problems with our lungs, okay? When you have right heart failure, you have no problems with your lungs because there's no fluid going through there to become edematous, right? It's only when we have left heart failure that we have problems in our lungs. So if you think about it that way, but what is going on? So let's say we're closed to Gilbert. What's the traffic look like in Santan? Not that much, right? It's all backed up in the lungs. It's not a lot getting through out to here. So still low blood pressure.
So the central venous pressure, when they take it, then that's like your go-to, your kind of end-all.
There is no way to determine right versus left heart failure except by your symptoms. JVD is usually right side. But think about, let's say that there's enough traffic and Gilbert's closed. It will push out all around the lungs, and then people start getting off the highway in here. Usually doesn't affect all the way back to the I-10. And so if we see JVD, it's usually because the backup's over here. It doesn't usually get all the way back through. But if the traffic's heavy enough, if it's rush hour, and there's a lot of volume trying to get from the airport to Santan, well, now this backup might get all the way back and start affecting the I-10.
So would the first sign for the left side be the charts?
The first sign for left side is probably going to be our edema. So we're going to talk about this next week when we do the heart failure lecture, but I want you to see that you can even extrapolate. I don't want you to learn a list for right side, left side. When I want you to see this picture in your head, if you're a picture person, and remember that if you are having right-sided trouble, we're going to have symptoms that show up, edema and swelling. Okay, JVD edema, because fluid just can't get back, so it's getting off the highway before then. And our side roads for right heart failure are going to be edema and swelling and things like that. If we have left heart failure, the backup starts in the lungs, and people start getting off the highway here in the lungs where there's less pressure. So then we have swelling and edema in your lungs. So the biggest difference between right heart and left heart failure is the lung involvement. Right heart failure, dry lungs. Left heart failure, wet lungs. That's really the only way we can tell, because the blood pressure on both isn't that great. They're both tachycardic. They're both trying to pump fluid through, because there's a couple of sensors out here in the aorta and in your carotid arteries. And those sensors are the ones saying, I'm not getting pressure. Work harder. Those sensors don't know what's going on in the roads. They're just sitting up there going, we're not getting pressure. We're not getting pressure. And that's what works your sympathetic and parasympathetic system, are those sensors in your carotids and in your aorta.
So what would be considered congestive heart failure then, or would it be more than...
No, we'll talk. Congestive heart failure is chronic. There's acute and chronic, and congestive heart failure is chronic. So let's just take that for right now so that you can just see how these things work. Right heart, lungs, left heart. Okay. Just take that as that for right now, and we'll go into the valves after a break. So, pause. We're going to take... All right, so let's take a tour to the valves now. We did right heart, lungs, left heart. Right heart, lungs, left heart. Let's talk about the valves in those. We all know we have an atrium and a ventricle on each side of the heart, right? So, I know. Oh, my God. I don't know how you're coming to me. We didn't do heart in block three, so I'm not sure. This is a great summary slide of what's in your right heart and your left heart. Okay? Right heart, atrium. Valve, ventricle, valve, lungs. Left heart, atrium, valve, ventricle, valve, and body. There is no valve in between the return, which is the vena cava, and your atrium. That can just dump free will. No valve to get into the heart. So this right atrium is not, there's no valve on the top to get into the heart. You can just get in. There's no valve from the lungs to return to the heart. You can just get in. But then there are valves controlling flow from the atrium to the ventricle. And there are valves controlling outflow. So we have tricuspid and mitral are your AV valves, or between your atrium and your ventricle. Pulmonary aortic, hey, these are labeled really nice. They're labeled where they go. Those are your outflow valves. So you have AV valves and outflow valves. And we will talk next week about when these valves are open and closed, because that's important. But when do you think these valves are open? The pulmonary and aortic. When do you think these valves that control traffic are open? In systole, that's when we push to the lungs and the body, right? So these are open during systole, and these are open then by default into diastole. So again, don't stress about memorizing all that. We're going to do it again next week. But I want you to kind of know that these valves are controlling flow, so that this, when these are closed, when do you think they are closed? If these are open during systole, these have to be closed. If these are open during diastole, they have to close during systole. Okay. If these are open during systole, when are they closed? In diastole. So they work together as a team. The tricuspid and the mitral are a team, and the aortic and the pulmonic are a team. So let's kind of go through here. If you like mnemonics, if you want to know which ones are in the right heart versus the left heart, TP is in the right heart, the tricuspid and the pulmonic. And Ma, mitral, and aortic are in the right heart. If you want to know AV valves versus outflow valves, this is the team, TM, and this is team TA.
Team, you know, and I put little too much and, you know. The thing is you kind of want to know which ones are in the right part, because if one of those is broken or not functioning, what kind of failure do you think you're going to have?
If the right heart ones are broken, you're going to have right heart failure. And if the left ones are broken, you're going to have left heart failure. So very easy to remember, hey, if I have aortic problem, it's in the left heart, so my symptoms are going to be left heart symptoms. If I have a tricuspid or pulmonary problem, they're in the right heart, and you're going to have right heart symptoms. But that doesn't help you remember which ones are AV valves and which ones are outflow valves. I like to remember just the ones that are named aortic and pulmonic. They go out, they're my outflow ones. The other two are the AV valves. But you remember however you want to remember. I like that. And so this is just going through the flow again. And this is just saying how everything flows. We go through the right heart, goes through the lungs, and then to the left heart. And I think this is where we start to play. Do you want to play? Should we play?
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to pause for a minute. So I understand that was, it seemed like chaos, but it is organized chaos, okay? So I need you to know what valves are open and closed during systole diastole, because that's going to make a difference when we have valve issues later on. And maybe as we start talking, you can kind of remember that love dub demo. We can even do it again next week as we go through the valves. But really, that's what I wanted to see, the visual of when those valves are closed. That is a physical barrier to that chamber emptying. And that's what we're looking at here. So that was the actual flow. Oh, thank you. You guys are so clean. I'll clean them up later. So valves are a physical obstruction to chambers emptying. And the chambers need to be able to empty to fill the next chambers. If there is a holdup, you can imagine, with a valve, guess what's going to happen? We're going to back up. So I will probably bring that demo to mind just so that you have that physical attachment to the demo. But for now, before we go to lunch, I'm going to talk about normal cardiac EKG, and then after lunch, we're going to talk about the abnormals. Okay? So we're going to let flow go for a little while, because in my mind, this flowing unit with all of that chaos, guess what is stimulating that chaos?
Electrical
activity. So if I had really been doing this demo as a real heart, just to explain to you how complex it is not only those valves opening and closing due to pressure, but it is electrical stimulation causing these chambers to squeeze, to get ready to squeeze. If there's no electrical activity, the chambers don't have any stimulus to do their sponge motion, okay, and to get rid of anything. Otherwise, they just kind of dribble. They just dribble stuff. They have no squeeze. They have no stand up and throw. They just kind of dump. So let's talk about the normal electrical conduction. Any cardiac cell can generate an electrical impulse. And any cardiac cell can relay impulses to neighboring cells. This is important because we do have a pacemaker area of the heart. And that is called the SA node. We have two nodes in our heart, and they are situated in between the right atrium and the right ventricle. There's two nodes, okay, sitting right in the little space in between. The SA node is your pacemaker cell for the atriums, okay? So if I'm going to draw, let me draw a little picture here that I think is a little bit better. You're going to get tired of me in all my drawings. If we have the right atrium and the right ventricle and the left atrium and the left ventricle.
Ooh, really?
Ooh, my teeth.
Get it?
R-E-N.
What's it? That's an RA. Come on.
It's an RA.
Okay, right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle.
in the muscles around that, here is your SA node, and here is your AV node. This is for electrical conduction, and these are our pacemaker nodes. This sends electricity out to the atriums, okay? This sends electricity out to the ventricles, okay? Hey, easy peasy, right? But we don't want them competing with each other. We don't want them doing different rates. So what happens is, let's undo these. What happens is the SA node sends signals around to the right atrium, and then the atrium send it back to the AV node. Once the electricity hits the AV node, then the AV node sends signal to the left ventricle, okay, or to the ventricles. So what happens is the SA node sends signals around to the atrium, and then it gets sent back to the AV node, and then that AV node sends it around to the ventricles, okay? So the SA node is really our pacemaker node. Now let's say the SA node is out of commission. Doesn't work. Broke. Out of, you know, decided it wanted to die off or take a break or go to Hawaii. The SA node's broken. Now what happens? The AV node takes over and is just sending messages out to the ventricle. So it will not take over on its own usually. The AV node is submissive. It lets the SA node do its thing and it waits. But if it never hears anything, it will take over and become a pacemaker. So the SA node is our pacemaker node for our heart.
But the AV node
can do it.
But only to the ventricles?
Only to the ventricles.
Okay.
Correct. The AV node will never send signals out to the atrium. The AV node controls the ventricle. So those are our pacemaker cells, but really our SA node is the pacemaker because it's the one that decides. The AV node just falls in if there's nothing. And that's what's known as a junctional rhythm, is when the AV node is doing its work. But anyway, what we do is we wait for the pacemaker node. Beats that are happening outside of those two nodes are considered arrhythmic or aberrant, or they're not supposed to happen. Those are our two cells that are signed off to send out electrical beats. Anything else that does it is doing it on its own. It's just a rogue little cell, but they can all do it. Electricity is the stimulus for contraction. So electricity is what makes those muscles excited to contract. So the P wave, the first wave we see that's normal, is the SA node conducting around the atrium, that first step that we saw. That's the SA node sending it out, sending it around the atrium, and then it's gathering back in the AV node. So here's your SA node, and here's your AV node. So the SA node goes, time to go, sends it around, and then it gathers in the AV node, and then waits to be sent out. And this is when it's gathered in the AV node and waiting to get sent back out, is when the atrium now can contract. So this is electricity traveling. The flat parts of the EKG are when contraction actually happens. All right, electricity goes first, and then we have contraction. So the PR intervals, all these intervals, are when we actually have contraction. This is when the atrium actually squeeze and empty into the ventricles. When is this happening? What time? Systole or diastole?
No, diastole.
It's diastole. When the heart is at rest is when the atriums are squeezing in and filling the ventricles. Okay? But that happens in the intervals. This is electricity moving. This is contractility. Okay? So if the heart's going to do something, it's going to do something in the flat parts of the EKG. So then what's going to happen next? Now the AV node's going to send its stored signal out to the ventricles, right? And that looks like the QRS. All right? So here's the AV node starting to send it. And what we're seeing, when you see these QRSs, we're doing is we're seeing, there is no one way for this QRS to look. Have you seen them upside down? Yes, that is just whatever lead is looking. Is the electricity coming towards it or away from it? So when this is looking, this is saying that our looking lead is down here on this part of the chest. So it's looking, it's waiting, it's watching for electricity coming at it. And when electricity is coming at it, it's shown as an upward trend. When electricity goes away from it, it's shown as a downward trend. So what we're doing when we are looking at this one lead, let me draw again. This is, let's say we have, this is the, here's our, let's just do three leads. What color lead is this up here? This is our white one. This one is, and this one is red. We have smoke over fire. I like green and white are on the right, Christmas on the bottom, so green and red go on the bottom. So green and white are on the right, so I know that white's always on the right. There's all kinds of mnemonics, and I have that there. So when you are looking, what lead do you think would give you this QRS rhythm? Is where the looking lead is down here, because it's looking at the electricity coming at it and giving positive feedback. And then when the electricity goes away from it, like here, it goes away, goes down. So if you had a lead, let's say that this was our looking lead, what would the EKG, the QRS look like coming here? Is it going away from it?
It's coming toward it.
It's going away from it. So we have a regular little P wave. And then what's our Q wave going to look like?
It's
going to be downward. It's going to be downwards because during this period, it's going away. This is the looking lead right here. It's going to be going away from the looking lead, right? And then as it comes around and goes back, it goes up. So when you have an upside down QRS, it just means you're probably in the wrong lead, that you're not used to seeing things. Lead two has the looking lead down here. This is lead two, has the looking lead down here, and that's the lead we usually use, okay? If we have the looking lead anywhere else, this is usually lead one, and this is lead three. So that means that's where your looking lead is. So if you're in lead one, and this is your looking lead, what is your QRS going to look like? It's going away from you, so it will be going down. And then it's coming back up, it will be up. It's upside down. So depending on what lead you are, so if you want to see an upright QRS, go to lead two, because that's when you get an upright QRS. Don't worry about knowing all that. But upside down QRSs are not a problem. It just means your looking lead is changed. So when someone changes from lead one to lead three, the whole QRS changes. There's nothing wrong with the heart. It's just the way we're looking at it. So that's kind of what I wanted to show you. And that's like the whole heart of the 12-lead EKG is what the electricians are looking at. So don't worry about whether the QRS is up or down. That's not a significant finding at all. It just means that we're looking that electricity is going down and then back up. Somewhere, somehow, depending on no matter what lead it's looking at, the QRS should look like a point. Whether it's upside down or right side up, doesn't matter. Does that make sense? We just want to see a QRS, that little triangle looking thing. Then what's going to happen is after that's done, then we have ventricle contract. So the ventricle is going to contract in the ST segment. So we have the PR between the P and the R. This is atrial contraction, and then we have ventricular contraction there in the flat parts. Okay? And then we have the T wave where everything resets to go again. Okay? So electricity goes around and around and around in a cycle. So this one, I don't know if this is going to work. Let's see. I tried to update this. This sends you to a site where you can see the whole thing going around, and you can watch it. So now you can see kind of the whole electricity going around and contracting, and you can see how the whole thing works. Do you see these valves are opening and closing the way they should? They don't show the pulmonic valve on here, but these are your AV valves. So this is your tricuspid and your mitral valve, and this is your aortic valve. So you can kind of watch that if you like looking at visuals. That is what is going on. The electricity goes first, and then there is contraction. So I like that. I like that little picture. Go away. All right. So this is where we kind of can put everything together. Normal. So this is that. Here's the right side of the heart. Here's the left side of the heart. And here is what we're doing. And here's what the EKG looks like during each time. Now, do I need you to know all this? No, this is for your, if you like putting everything together. There will not be a test on this one. I just want you to kind of know how the normal heart works. What I do need you to know, I don't even need you to know these or how to put these on. This is for clinical, right? If someone says put leads on, I would like you to know how to put leads on. But I don't need you to know all of that for the test. I won't need you to know how to put on 12 leads, but if you do ever have to put on a 12 lead, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then all of these around. And I think when you're talking about the 6 leads, they probably have V1 and V2, and just none of the rest of these. So it's probably 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's probably what they're looking at with the 6 leads. But what we're doing with that is we are looking, and we're giving a lot more looking points, so we can see a lot more about what's going on with the electricity. That's all we're doing with the 12-lead EKG, is looking at a lot of different angles, and then we can see what's going on. I will need you to know how to read an EKG. So all the rest of that stuff was just basically get it if you want to, understand if you want to, and now we're starting to go into, okay, what do I need you to know? Here it is. Here's the beginning of what I need you to know. I would like you to know how to look at an EKG and be able to count how fast it's going and what these intervals are. So I'm going to need you to know that any strip I give you on the test of the NCLEX is going to be a 6-second strip. Okay? Easy peasy, because what we can do is once we get a 6-second strip, you just multiply whatever's on there by 10 to get your heart rate. Does that make sense? 6 seconds, multiply it by 10, you get 60 seconds, and that's your heart rate per minute. Yes?
When they have it at the hospital, is that
what prints out for you? If you just hit print, it's usually a 6-second strip. That's a pretty standardized thing, but you can always check at the top of EKG paper are 3-second intervals, and you should have two of those 3-second intervals that print out. And that's generally a 6-second strip is a standard strip. So what we're going to do is you just count the number of QRSs that show up in that 6-second strip and multiply it times 10, and that's your heart rate. I am going to tell you that there are these little teeny tiny boxes. So each teeny tiny little box, if you're measuring anything, this big box here, I'll go back. Go back. This box right here is a big box. All right, when I say larger square represents 0.2 seconds, I'm talking about this guy. This is 0.2 seconds. When I say the smallest square, let's see if I can blow this up so I can smell it. That is this little guy down here. That little guy down there is 0.04. So, of course, 5 of them, which is what this is, equals 0.2 seconds. So just know these big boxes and these big lines are 0.2 seconds, okay? Because that's what you're probably going to need to be able to read those intervals. But if you have a box and a line, that's 0.2 plus 0.04, it's 0.24, okay? So I will probably give you the intervals rather than have you. You don't have calipers on the exam where you can sit there and measure the actual intervals. So on the exam, I will probably give you the intervals. And then you need to know if they are normal or not. So that is on the next screen. Here are our normal intervals. So our normal rate is 60 to 100. We all know that, right? No problem. So let's look at this one right here. What's the heart rate on this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times 10 is 80. All right, very easy to get rate off of these 6-second strips. You just measure the cues or the points, and you're done. Regular. We will need to know if it's regular. How do we know if it's regular? Is if this R-R interval is the same each time. You will probably be able to, if you're looking for regularity and everything, you can tell, even from last semester, as I look here. You can take your little scratch piece of paper. This is probably exactly the same as last semester. Let's see. What you do is you take a little piece of paper, if you don't have magical things called caliper, and you just take your piece of paper and you go from the edge of the paper to here and make a mark. And then you check with all of these. It should be exactly the same, right? That's a regular rhythm. They are perfectly timed. Great. Regular is the R to R distance, equal in every interval. That's normal. P waves. We just care that they exist right now. Do they exist? What are they? This first big fat one after the QRS is a T wave. And then we have a P wave before. So it just goes P, QRS, T, P, QRS, T. We don't do any of the rest of the alphabet. So if we see two waveforms, we just assume the one closest to the QRS is the T and the one closest to the QRS on the other side is the P. Okay. So we just want to know if P's are present. And then we want to know if there's a P wave before every QRS complex. Well, yeah, there should be. The P wave is the atrium conduction and the QRS is the ventricle conduction. So they should be happening. Then we look at the widths, the time it takes for conduction to go around the atrium to the ventricle. This normal one is about one, like half a box to a box long. So you have to look at these, and I will give you these intervals. I'll tell you what they are if I need you to measure them on the test. But what we do is we start at the beginning of the P, and we go to the R, which is in the middle of the QRS, and you measure that. So right there, that's a little less than one box wide, right? So one box is about as long as it should be. If it's anything less than that, we're fine. It just means things are moving real quick around the atrium. So when you go from the edge of your paper at the beginning of the P to the R, and then you just can take that up to your box and measure it. It's less than one big box, and we're good. Because the normal interval is less than one big box, right? One big box is 0.2. So we can do 3 to 5 small boxes or less than one big box. All right, we're good there with the PR interval. The QRS is very narrow. It doesn't take a lot of time to move around. It should only be 1.5 to 3 small boxes. It's very tiny and narrow. The PR interval is much longer than the QRS interval. And then the QT width is the time it takes the heart to be ready. And that we measure from the beginning of the Q to the end of the T. You will see that as we look at different drugs and things, you'll see that they affect how long these intervals are. Some drugs slow the heart down and prolong intervals, allowing the heart more time to repolarize and do things. The only reason I tell you this is so that we can apply it later. But that's what normal looks like. So when you go in here, you can come and do some test questions, and there's games and there's things to practice and all that. And that is the end of normal. So we talked about normal.